All right, so welcome to our Christmas in July Island Style. During the summer, Pastor Dave has taken a hiatus from leading us in our adult Bible study, and we've just taken up various discussions on topics that interest us instead. So I have always wanted to share the sermon that my grandfather wrote in 1944 and never really had an opportunity until now to be able to read it. My grandfather was born in Wisconsin, and when he wrote this sermon, he was a minister at two parishes, one in Lorium and one in St. John's in Hubble. So his sermon starts with the two verses of the Christmas song, which I wasn't familiar with when I read the verses, but once Hazel played it a little bit, I was like, oh, I do know that tune. A little something interesting about this hymn is that it was translated by Carth for the Lutheran Church book in Philadelphia, which was published in 1869, long time ago. It is known as Carth's best-known work in hymnals, and it has nine verses. We're just going to sing the first two. So you have a copy of it, and Hazel is going to lead us with Rick's help.
Comes once more, the heavenly guest is at the door, the blessed words, the shepherds thrill, the joyous tidings, peace, goodwill.
Familiar? Did it sound kind of? Another thing that I just wanted to mention is this is to just be fun and informal. Don't be afraid to share, or if you have a question, or I really found inspiration from something. That's how our Bible study really is created, that we all share different viewpoints. When you hear a message, it might bring a memory or two, and please feel free to share that. So I will start with Grandpa's sermon. We are today celebrating our fourth wartime Christmas. Both they who guide the ship of state and also the military leaders were extremely optimistic when they predicted that at least one phase of this cruel war would be concluded by the end of this year. It is now apparent that this conflict is by no means over. On the contrary, the war is growing more bloody and fierce. The casualty list is increasing. The enemy is defending his home soil with deadly fanaticism. Ambassadors and diplomats and legislatures are still at odds. The lust for power and world trade has not been satisfied. The threefold demon, namely envy, hatred, and malice, is working feverishly. Settingfold demon, namely nation against nation, father against son, and son against father, Apparently, Satan is again having his evil way. Can men, in the face of these evil conditions, celebrate Christmas, the birth of the Savior of the world? Is it possible to rejoice in the gospel of the Nativity when that which the Son of God brings to earth is apparently overthrown and rendered void by greedy and selfish men? Can we celebrate a peaceful Christmas in wartime? The answer to these questions is yes. The blessed gospel of the birth of the Son of God has lost none of its grace and power. The message of the angel first spoken to the shepherds on the fields of Bethlehem still echoes and resounds throughout the world, promising to all who will accept it pardon, peace, and lasting joy. Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. At long last, and rescue men from sin and its consequences. The angels in heaven knew the boundless grace of God, which provided man's salvation in the multitude of the heavenly host appeared upon earth to praise this divine saying grace and to show the effect which this grace will have among men by whom it is received. Reads the song of the angels, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men. It is not for mortals either to doubt or to question the message of the angel in the song of the angelic choir. It is rather for us to accept, to believe, to rejoice, and to ponder the grace of God, which bringeth salvation, and which hath appeared unto all men in the gift of the Christ child, who for our sakes became poor, that we through his poverty might be rich. The babe of Bethlehem has reconciled you to your God. He wishes to enter your heart and fill it with peace, joy, and happiness. He wishes to enter your life in order to remake you into a loving and peaceable child of God. More than ever before, sinful, hating, and warring mortals need the gospel of Christ. It alone can change them into the image of the kind, gentle, and loving Savior. When men have tasted the sweet peace of God, won for them by Christ, they will strive to live at peace among themselves. The lust for power, gain, and possessions has become an obsession among men. It is the cause of all this strife and war. Jesus said, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." God gave his dearest and best when he gave his only begotten Son to be our Savior from sin. And in him, God will freely give us all things. Let us then accept this gift anew and learn of him to be forgiving, meek, and mild. That the Christ child may come anew into your hearts with his renewing grace and sanctifying power and give you peace and joy is the prayer of your pastor. For me, I felt, even though this was written a long time ago, so much in our nation is struggling right now. We're at war with COVID. There's war in other countries, and our hearts are heavy. And I think that we need to remember every day is can be Christmas, and we need to celebrate God's gift of his son. So Bill, I shared this with you beforehand, and you have something that you'd like to share. So do you want to read that, or should we sing a song? We can sing Angels We Have Heard on High.
Grandfather's message from 1944, I remember that I had a little book on my shelf called Sons of Anak, A-N-A-K, or Anak, something like that. Anyway, it's an Old Testament figure, I think. But that man was who wrote, it's a book of sermons. They're not long sermons. That's why I bought it, I think. Years and years ago, it was published in 1964. It was written full of messages, and I remember one that stood out in that book. It was called One Miracle is Enough. The author is David H.C. Reed. He succeeded George Buttrick, who was a well-known pastor at Madison Avenue Presbyterian Church in New York City. So he came to New York City. But in 1941, he was a chaplain in the army in the war in Europe. And this sermon comes out of an experience he had at Christmas in 1941. And I've given a page to, six people, and I've got the ending paragraph of it and the prayer that follows, and I'll take care of that. But I think if you look at your book, folks who got those pages of this sermon, and your sentence on the end doesn't end in a sentence, bring up your successor with it, okay? Number one is, I think, Cindy. And Candy is gonna follow her, so, and just watch your page and see if it doesn't end in a sentence. Get up here while the other one is reading.
One miracle is enough. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth, John 1:14. December 1941 was a bitterly cold month in Europe. From the Pyrenees to the Volga, it seemed as though winter held every land in its frozen grip. With snow lying thick and bitter, and winds whistling through towns and villages where there was an almost universal shortage of food and fuel. For it was not only winter that reigned over that huge territory. The Nazi war machine, at the height of its power, had its frozen grip, too, on the lives of millions, all the way from the Spanish frontier to central Russia. I remember it well, for at that time I was an army chaplain in a German prison camp, temporarily located on a disused race course on the outskirts of Rouen in France. In the camp were about 1,000 Allied prisoners of war, mostly crippled and disabled. They had been a brief hope that they might be sent home.
Home by Christmas was the happy thought, but instead of that, word had just come that we were to be sent back across that wintry Europe to the frontiers of Poland. It was not the brightest prospect for a happy Christmas. In the huts, men huddled together, trying to keep warm, while outside the German sentries, muffled to the ears, stamped miserably around the barbed wire enclosure, hardly more free, and certainly not more comfortable than we were. Then something happened. Call it a miracle, if you'd like, but it had nothing to do with any sudden transformation of our material conditions. No angel came to tear the wire down. No manna fell from the skies. We were still prisoners in the hands of the enemy. But for a day or two, the camp was transformed. And what I remember now is not the cold or the hunger, but some little things that were the symbol of this transformation. The German commandant, for instance, unexpectedly ordering into the camp an enormous Christmas tree, and a group of hard-bitten prisoners designing and signing an elaborate Christmas card, which I presented to the commandant at midnight in the silence of his office. Then there was that brew of weak cocoa, which was taken out to shivering guard on Christmas Eve, and the cigarettes that were slipped across the wire from the outside. And there was the moment when I heard a magnificent tenor voice resounding from one of the huts. When I looked inside, I saw a massive Feldwebel, complete with belt and revolver, singing to a group of babbly, crippled prisoners, Schlag nach, Heilig nach, Silent Night, Holy Night.
Meaningless sentiment? Sentiment, if you like, but certainly not meaningless. The miracle was in the overflow of the Christmas spirit in the midst of war. For a time at least, in spite of the titanic struggle to which we were entirely committed, human beings were human beings, and the memory of the one who was born to bring all mankind to the peace and joy of God, which prevailed over human hate and despair and squalor. I have never since been able to be cynical about the fringe benefits of Christmas. The sparkle of light that comes into drab streets, the excitement of children, the happiness of genuine giving to please another, the wave of good humor that sweeps over even the most unlikely people, the desire to forget quarrels and to be reconciled. I said fringe benefits for this miracle of transformation that we have all experienced in some way, however small, derives from the greatest miracle of all time. We didn't just invent Christmas. There was no group of people who got together years ago and said, let's have a holiday once a year when everyone will try to be happy and kind. We invented a lot of the trappings, the holly, the cards, the trees, the presents, even the date. But no man invented the fact behind Christmas. It was a gift of God. It was the birth of a child, the gift of a person like none other who has ever lived. The fact behind Christmas is the appearance on our earth of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. What is the miracle of Christ? It is himself. It's not the wonderful stories connected with his birth or even the amazing things that he was able to do. The real miracle
centers on his person, who he was and is. When you read the New Testament, you find that his followers are overwhelmed by the wonder of Christ himself. From the moment that he turned to his disciples and asked the question, "Who do you say that I am?" and Peter answered, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God," everyone who made that discovery wanted to shout it to the world. It wasn't his miracles they spoke about so much as the miracle himself. God has visited and redeemed his people, they cried. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself. God has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of Christ in the face of Jesus Christ. To hear these eyewitnesses is to catch again something of the awe, the wonder, the excitement, the joy with which men experienced and communicated the miracle of Christ. Something new had happened, something unheard of, something almost unbelievable. To believe it transformed their lives. Here was the secret of life and the secret of death. To me, said St. Paul, to live is Christ and to die is gain. One of the disciples, looking back over all that had happened and trying to find the words to express the wonder of it, wrote down these extraordinary words that have never ceased to echo in the Christian church. The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. How often do we stop to think of the words when we sing the carols?
The best of the carols are not about the fringe of Christmas, but about its center. And there's more solid theology sung at the street corners at this time of the year than you will sometimes find in our pulpit. Listen, word of the Father, now in flesh appearing, O come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Word of the Father, God's word, God speaking to us, God communicating with his people. That's the basis of all living religion. When the old prophets wanted to indicate that they had something to say in the name of God, they used the expression, hear the word of the Lord. Words are our symbols of communication, and so God's word is God's communicating. And that word has come to man in many ways, through prophets and teachers, through stories and poems, through commandments and ordinances, through experience and through the silence of the conscious. But the astounding miracle of Christmas is the personal appearance of God's word on earth, the translating of the word into flesh and blood. There is no mistaking what the New Testament tells us. We can accept the miracle or reject it, but they want us to know just what they believed and what has been believed by Christmas ever since. In Jesus Christ, who was born in a stable, lived the plain, tough life of his day, died on a Roman cross, and was seen again alive by his disciples, God has come personally into our human life.
Here is how another apostle put it. When in former times God spoke to our forefathers, he spoke in fragmentary and varied fashion through the prophets. But in this final age, he has spoken to us in the Son, whom he has made heir to the whole universe. There is the miracle that is beyond all other miracles, the one miracle that is enough. If in any way we respond to this, finding in Christ the image of God, the way to God, the life of God flowing into ours, then we don't need to be too much concerned with any other miracles in the Bible or elsewhere. A living faith is not measured by the amount of incredible stories we can swallow. So often people speak as if it were more virtuous to accept a vast number of miracles than to be only committed to a few. And sometimes men and women are blocked from considering this one supreme miracle of Christ, because they are told they must first believe all kinds of things they find it impossible to accept. This miracle is enough, that Jesus Christ is God's word made flesh, dwelling among us. When the wonder of that event really gets hold of me, that Almighty God has taken our nature, really becoming man in order to rescue and redeem us, then I don't find it at all strange that other unique things should have happened that are associated with him. But none of them, except the resurrection, which is the crown and seal of the incarnation story, is of cardinal importance. Compared with this stupendous claim, for it is in Christ, St. Paul says, that the complete being of
the Godhead dwells embodied. No other story of strange and inexplicable events has any great significance. So let's come to the center of the Christmas season. If there is still such a thing as the Christmas spirit in this modern world, if kindness and compassion seem to glow just a little more brightly, and love breaks through in unexpected places, if God seems strangely active in the lives of his human family, if hope burns more brightly in spite of the sins and follies of our times, then it is because a miracle has happened in this world. The miracle of the Word be made flesh, of God becoming human. It was this human he became, this Jesus who alone and supreme among all before and since his day, the perfect reflection of the Father. No matter what goes on around us in this turbulent world, no matter what may happen in the days ahead, we still behold his glory, the glory as of the only begotten Father, full of grace and truth. In Christ, we know the love, the transforming power, the saving truth, the infinite grace of God, translated into the flesh and blood of our everyday life. This is the miracle, and it is enough. Let us pray. O God, we seek beyond the man-made lights of our day, the everlasting flame of thy glory and thy love, beyond the confusing sounds of the present hour, the word that comes from thee. Forgive our absorption in transient material things, and lift our minds to the peace and purity of thy presence through Jesus Christ our Lord. In this glad season, refresh us with a new vision of our Lord and Savior. May we know Jesus in the shadows as well as the radiance of every day. Give us the childlike spirit of trust in your care, of joy in your gifts, and of wonder at the mystery of life and the secret of your presence. Sustain us with your grace, all who are bringing health to the body, calm to the mind, nourishment to the soul, and fortify with patience those who seek to do your will in hard and hostile circumstances. May this holy season bring refreshment to all the forces of goodwill throughout the world, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And O God, by whom the meek are guided in judgment, and light riseth up in darkness for the godly, grant us in our doubts and uncertainties the grace to ask what thou wouldst have us to do, that the spirit of wisdom may save us from all false choices, and in thy light we may see light, and in thy straight path may not stumble, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Suzanne wanted people to talk for a little bit about what you've experienced so far. So, what do you think? What did you hear in all of this so far?
I hear today.
Okay, you hear today. Why don't you take the mic around so they can kind of... Sorry, listening in audience will be able...
Her grandfather's paragraphs. The first paragraph was
closer.
Was okay. It was about our day to day. I mean, it's no different. The chaos that surrounds us in the midst. And in some sense, that's always true of Christmas, I guess, because we're human beings. So that's what I'm thinking.
Okay. Someone else? Oh, Oh, don't be shy.
It just reminded me of the words love and peace, and I think that's something I've needed during this time of everything that's going on in the world, and it just how important it is to remember that.
Okay. It's really nothing new that anybody else hasn't said, but I agree, it's about today. It seems like we're really stuck in power and who's right, who's wrong, and there's no compromise. People can't talk civilly because they want to be right and they want to have the power in the world. So it echoes with what's going on, like other people have said.
Okay, anybody else? I guess one of the questions I would raise for people, because it's the first one, Suzanne gave me the sermon ahead of time too, so I could read it. What is it, if we really believe that this peace is, that passes understanding, is at work in the world and is powerful even amidst all the things we've got going on right now, what does that mean we do? What do we do with that?
I don't know. I think, and I mean it to be a cop-out, but I think one of the few things we can do, and it might be powerful, is if everybody just tries to lead by example, mm-hmm. and, you know, get into open discussions without saying, you know, my way is the only way, and again, just try to lead by example and not say I'm always right, but this is what I think, what do you think, and mm-hmm. talk through things and try to be peaceful about it and not antagonistic about it.
Okay, I think that's a great. Any other thoughts people have of what we do if we're people of the Savior who comes to bring peace? And or I was especially struck with his comments at the end where he said that let them accept the gift anew and learn of him to be forgiving, meek, and mild. I mean, that's a really different spin on life than we normally find in the world. How do we live that out in what we do?
The church is divided. It's not just the world, the population. The church is divided. And I saw a piece last night that's talking about the right is moving towards what's called Christian nationalism. And the gospel is about all humanity, not just white Americans. We're up against a real terrible enemy in our political situation right now. Kind of masking Christianity in order to get power in our political system.
Okay. And so how do we enter into that kind of saying, that's not what we want to be? How do we do that peacefully? I mean, I think Jim had some good thoughts that we stop, we listen, we're more respectful of one another, we set examples. Is there anything else we?
Well, we keep gathering, that's for sure.
Okay.
That's what I have to do that. I have to come here.
Okay.
I'm drawn here by people that surround me right now and okay. others.
So we encourage each other. We hold each other up in the midst right. of that. And
get the young people out to vote.
in a very small way, when I do open mics in public, I try to choose songs about peace and love and mm-hmm. try to get people to sing along with me.
Yep. Draw them in to that whole thing. Jackie, in the back there.
It's on. Okay. All right. I tried not to talk, but here I am.
It's hard, isn't it, Jackie?
Yeah. I can't hold it in anymore. Okay, the big thing about today is the media and our access to information, any information. So we begin to think that everything is bad, and especially the media, which goes after the negative, because if it bleeds, it reads. And so what we don't hear are the kindness, the kind things people do, the good things people do. That's not news. And in a way, I feel sorry for the younger generation that didn't know that. They're just fed this negativity day in and day out. And so we really have to hold on to the word of the Bible.
Mm-hmm. That kind of leads into what I was thinking. We're living in a kind of in an age of outrage. You know, there's a lot to be outraged about, but not everything. So we've been carping about gas prices going up for how many weeks now? Has anybody noticed what's going on with gas prices? Down another dime. Let's be happy about, you know, that little thing. And let's talk about the gas prices having gone down like 70 cents in a couple of weeks. But I think we tend to be kind of so wrapped up with our outrage of stuff that we don't maybe take the time to just enjoy some of the good things. Now we just need it to go down another dollar.
Well, and along with that, I mean, I think it's interesting. I think one of the things that also is in line with this whole idea of peace and understanding and things is that we also have to understand why those prices went up. They went up because we wanted to support people who were being oppressed and attacked, to offer a way to, without sending bombs and troops over there, to say, we support you and where you're at. That was part of why gas prices go up, you know? And if we believe that that's one of the things we should be doing, then we have to accept that. Along with that goes rising prices, you know? We may not agree with that solution, but that we have to recognize that that's what the hope was when we said we're not going to buy Russian oil anymore. And that's, you know, there's a consequence that goes with that decision. Anything else that people want to throw into this discussion?
I'm not sure if this is in the same vein of thought, but something that has me very concerned is erasing real history and the worry of offending people by stating what truly happened in the 60s or what truly happened with slavery. Textbooks denying that slavery really was it that bad, you know, and somehow we need to truly support true history, what truly happened to the Native Americans, what truly happened to the Black community. And until we can empathize with that history, how is it ever going to be, I can't think of the right word, I'm getting senile, but the empathy for that, those communities can only help but improve the future. If we keep living the lie and pretending that American history is the best in the world and we never did anything wrong, why are these people so mad? Why are the Blacks so upset? You know, we have to learn the truth and accept the truth and move forward from there.
Right, and along with that, I think we need to ask the question, are there effects from those historical things that continue on into today? Our own scripture says the sins of the father will be punished, you know, carried on in the children of the third and fourth generation. A lot of people want to say, well, it happened a long time ago. What's that got to do with us? But it does have to do with us. It shapes much of who we are today. And we have to at least ask those questions of ourselves if we're going to truly be people who try to be people who embrace everyone within
How many are familiar with the name Debbie Holland? H-A-A-L-A-N-D. She's the head of the Bureau of Indian Affairs for the country. And did you read any of the front of the Journal Sentinel, which now has had a special on Indian schools from the 1800s and 1900s and what we did to Native Americans in those schools?
In the name of Christianity.
In the name of Christianity. Yes. There's a lot of good stuff in the Journal Sentinel. They don't hide from things, anyway. But I was surprised.
Yeah, and along with that, I think part of what being people of peace is, too, is to, when we've done wrong, ask forgiveness. I don't know how many of you read that the Pope recently went to Canada and said, we are sorry as a church for the way our schools took Native peoples in Canada and basically tried to re-educate them, take away their history and their culture. We realize now that that's wrong. The beginning of any sort of conversation, I think, sometimes has to begin with that kind of confession and willingness to say, we need to forgive one another for the things that we've done. And we are sorry. We know that we did the wrong thing all those years ago. Anybody else have? I mean, I think this has just been a great sort of presentation of, and one that's very thought-provoking. And when Suzanne gave me this sermon ahead of time, I looked at it, and I couldn't help but think of a video I used, it must be 4 or 5 years ago now, in a Christmas Eve service. It's a video that's based on the events of 1914, World War I, on Flanders Field in Belgium. And those who are listening online can go to the, we'll have a little place for you to click and go to this, but here it is for us. That can help us cross boundaries, find common ground. These are the things that we still have the opportunity to do in our world today. It really is a powerful video put together kind of as a remembrance of this Christmas truce 100 years later. Or not 100, 100, because they did it in 2014. So take a look at it. It's really a powerful sort of message. And it's the answer to the last question, you know, to the question of this sermon. Can peace happen? Yeah, it can. You know, God's power is enough to bring peace wherever we are. And I think, is there something else? Another song?
A song.
A song.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and
Sometimes you need a spark to just light up your heart. And so I really appreciate you coming today. With that, I want to continue this wonderful feeling of love. And Rick is going to entertain us with some great ukulele music. And then follow.
Oh, Rick and Rick's out.
And this is for sure a sing along. You don't have handouts, but the songs you all know.
We're going to start with Deck the Halls.
Deck the halls with boughs of holly, fa la 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 la. 'Tis the season to be jolly, fa la 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 la. Don we now our gay apparel, fa la 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 la. Troll the ancient Yuletide carol, fa la 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 la. See the blazing Yule. See the blazing Yule before us, fa la 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 la. Strike the harp and join the chorus, fa la 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 la. Don't follow me in merry measure, fa la 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 la. While I tell of Yuletide treasure, fa la 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 la. Fast away the old year passes, fa la 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 la. Hail the new ye lads and lasses, fa la 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 la. Sing we joyous all together, fa la 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 la. Heedless of the wind and weather, fa la 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 la.
And a little Spanish from around the world. Feliz Navidad. Very repetitive. The only word or the phrase that sometimes throws people is the Prospero Año y Felicidad is a prosperous new year and happiness.
And you can do it in Spanish.
Yeah, or go like this up your lips. Let me find where I am. There it is.
Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Prospero año y felicidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Prospero año y felicidad. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Prospero año y felicidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Prospero año y felicidad. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart.
Oh, what a tight ending. Got the bells. I'm not sure where I'm gonna put them, but. This, of course, is Jingle Bells. dashing through the snow. You know, let's hold on a second. I got to get somebody else to play my bells.
Thank you.
2, 3, 4, kind of like that. Go ahead and start. Hazel will help us out with the jingle bell solo. Dashing through the snow in a one-horse open sleigh, a little quicker o'er the fields we go, laughing all the way. Bells on bobtail ring, making spirit bright. What fun it is to ride and sing a sleighing song tonight. Oh, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Hey, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. A day or two ago, I thought I'd take a ride, and soon Miss Fanny Bright was seated by my side. The horse was lean and lank, misfortune seemed his lot. He got into a drifted bank, and then we got upset. Oh, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Very fitting, of course, with the video that we just saw of Stille Nacht. We have a little silent night with narration.
On December 24th, 1818, a man in Austria named Joseph Mohr gave a poem he had written to a choir master and organist friend named Franz Gruber. He asked him to write music for his prose for two solo voices and guitar accompaniments because their organ was in need of repair due to some mice having chewed holes in the bellows. But he desperately wanted music to be part of the Christmas Eve service. Mr. Gruber then wrote the melody to what has become one of the most beloved of all Christmas carols, Stille Nacht, or in English, Silent Night.
Please join us.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round young birds. So tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly peace. Silent night, holy night, shepherds quake. Shepherds quake at the sight. Glory stream from heaven afar. Heavenly hosts, alleluia, alleluia. The Savior is born.
Son of God,
love, pure love,
radiant beams,
radiant beams from thy holy face, with the dawn of redeeming grace,
Jesus Lord,
Jesus Lord.
Merry Christmas. I want to wish you a Merry Christmas. I want to wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart.